سليم حسابي شديد العقاب أليم لعذابي عزيز السلطان. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له في الخلق والأمر. ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله المبعوث إلى الأسفل والأحمر المنعوت بشرح صدر ورفع ذكر. وصلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه الذين هم خلاصة العرب العرباء وخير الخلائق بعد الأنبياء. أما بعد، فيا أيها الناس وحد الله، فإن التوحيد رأس الطاعات، واتقوا الله فإن التقوى ملاك الحسنات. وعليكم بالسنة، فإن السنة تهدي إلى الإطاعة، ومن أطاع الله ورسوله فقد رشد واهتدى. وإياكم والبدعة، فإن البدعة تهدي إلى المعصية، ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل وغوى. وعليكم بالإحسان، فإن الله يحب المحسنين. وادعوه فإنه مجيب داع، واستغفروه يمددكم بأموال وبنين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. حافظوا على الصلوات والصلاة الوسطى، وقوموا لله قانتين. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He commands us, He instructs us in regards to our prayers. In the ayah of the Quran, from Surah Al-Baqarah that I quoted, that I mentioned, ayah number 238, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Hafidhu ala salawat. The word Hafidhu in the Arabic language comes from the word hifz. It means to protect something, to take care of something. But this is not just the word hifz. Hafidhu comes from muhafaza. This is a more advanced or sophisticated form of the word. The word muhafaza doesn't just mean protect something. It means to very carefully, very cautiously watch over something, protect something, safeguard something. فِيهِ مُبَالَغَةٌ الْمُبَالَغَةُ فِي الْحِفْظِ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says ala. The word ala in the Arabic language means over, on top of something. So Allah is telling us here, حَافِذُوا ala. Very carefully, very cautiously, very diligently, watch over. Why does Allah say over? Why on top of? Because when you want to protect something, when you want to take care of something, keep something safe, the best way to watch something, protect something, is to watch over it. That's why a watchtower is the highest point in a complex, so that you can see everything when you're on top of something. That's why when we install security cameras, we install them along the ceiling or at the highest point of the wall. Because when you are on top of something, you can keep an eye on anything getting closer. So Allah tells us, Hafidhu ala. Watch over. Watch over what though? Take care of what? To take so much care of. To put so much effort into protecting something. What is this thing that Allah wants us to take care of? As-salawat, the prayers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah commands us, watch over, take care of, protect. At all times, no matter what it takes, the prayers, your salah. Because this is the most valuable commodity. This is the most precious asset. This is the most valuable thing that we have, is our salah, our prayer. Why? لِأَنَّ الصَّلَاةَ سِنَةٌ بَيْنَ الْعَبْدِ وَرَبِّهِ. Because the prayer is the connection between us and Allah. That is our connection. And this is the most precious, the most valuable thing that we have. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said that the distinction between Iman and Kufr is Salah. This is why the Prophet ﷺ told us, somebody who missed their prayer, somebody who loses their Salah, is like somebody who lost their family and all their wealth. It's like they lost everything if you lose your shalom. It's so precious, so valuable. And I want us to think practically about how we protect something very valuable in our lives. How do we take care of something? If you have something that is very precious, very valuable, how do you protect it? You don't leave it out in the open. It's not even in your home, in the living area. You have a room all the way in the back of the house. And in that room in the back of the house, you'll have a safe. And this is something that you will lock inside of the safe. That's how you protect something that is truly valuable. That's how the type of effort we need to put into protecting our salah. Now this message from Allah here, Hafidhu ala salawat, very carefully protect your prayer. This in and of itself is very valuable. Very, very beneficial. But I want us to take a step further. The Quran, the Book of Allah, is the most remarkable gift ever given to humanity. And Allah commands us, Allah tells us that in the Quran, reflect, ponder upon the Quran. There are layers upon layers upon layers of understanding, tadabbur and tafakkur, that are built into the Quran. And we have to continue to read and study and learn from what the Quran is saying. Not just what it is saying, but how it is saying what it is saying. So this ayah, ayah number 238 of Surah Al-Baqarah, has a very powerful message. But something that's very interesting is all the ayat before it, from ayah number 228 till ayah number 238, 10 ayat, which is very long ayat. It's like more than 1.5 page of the Muslim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been talking about divorce. Ayah number 228 till 238, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about divorce, problems in the home, problems in a marriage, families not getting along, couples are fighting with each other. And then after Allah has been talking about divorce and problems in the home for 10 ayat, then he says, very carefully, very cautiously, take care of the prayer. And then for the next 3-4 ayat, all the way to ayah number 242, Allah goes right back to talking about divorce again. Now the question is, what does taking care of the prayers have to do with the subject of divorce and families fighting? How is that connected to this? Because everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran has a purpose, has a maqsad, has a meaning. I am a human being. So if I'm talking about one thing and then I just switch to a different topic, I can do that. Why? Because I'm a human being. I forgot what I was talking about. I got distracted and I started talking about something else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forget what he was talking about. He subhanahu wa ta'ala does not get distracted. How did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala go from talking about problems in the family to talking about prayer to then going back to talking about problems in the family? How is this all connected? We have to think. We have to think about this. And so the Mufassirun, the scholars of the Quran, they explain this to us. The thing they explain here, very powerful, is that, number one, that when somebody is having problems in their personal lives, maybe you're having a problem at work, you're having issues with the people you work with, you're having problems with your neighbors, you're having problems in the community with the brothers, you're having problems at home, with your wife, with your husband, with your children, with your siblings, your brothers and sisters, your parents. When you are having problems, when you are struggling in your personal life, that is a lot of times a symptom, an effect, an athar of you having problems in your relationship with Allah. concept of barakah, barakah, blessing, in Islam, is that barakah and blessing only comes from Allah. And the difference between a good situation and a bad situation is a lot of times the difference between having barakah and not having blessing, not having any barakah. And barakah only comes from Allah. So if I am connected to Allah, if I am talking to Allah every day, I'm making salah, I'm making dua, I have a relationship with my Creator, with my Khaliq, my Rabb, then everything in my life will have that barakah and that blessing. But if I cut off my relationship with Allah, everything else in my life will start to crumble. And so Allah, while talking about having problems in the home, Allah says, reconnect with Allah. Allah is telling us to reconnect with Him. Because if I reconnect with Allah, that will help me fix the problems going on in my home and my family. So the husband and the wife are fighting. Allah is saying, take a break from fighting and go and pray and think about what you're doing and then come back and talk. And see if that doesn't work. That's the first point here. Understanding that we are, as human beings, we are physical creatures, makhluq. We are physical creatures, but we are also spiritual beings. We have a ruh. And if we do not take care of our hearts, we do not take care of our souls, we do not take care of our relationship with Allah, the body itself, the jism will be empty and hollow. And it will not give benefit. It will not have barakah and blessing. This is the first point. The second thing that I wanted to mention here, and this is very interesting. Salah is something, prayer, salah, is something that not only helps us connect with Allah and improves our relationship with Allah, salah teaches us certain things, certain lessons. It builds within us certain good habits that will be helpful, will be beneficial in all areas of our life. The scholars in Mufassirun, they mention four habits, four characteristics, four sifat that salah teaches you, that will help you in your relationship with other people, will help you in your everyday practical life. What are these four sifat? Number one, salah teaches you responsibility. Salah teaches you responsibility. It teaches you how to be responsible. Because you see, one of the biggest problems that we have in homes, in families, in personal lives, is a lack of responsibility. People are not responsible. People are not taking their responsibility seriously. Salah teaches you to be responsible. While you have five prayers every day, at Fajr time you are tired, you are sleeping, but you wake up because I have a responsibility. There's a mas'uliyah, a responsibility. At Dhuhr time, you're busy, work, job, business, but you take a break because I have a responsibility. At Asr time, you want to go home, you want to close your shop, you want to finish your work. But not before you take care of your responsibility. Asr. Maghrib. You get home, you're tired, you're hungry. But first I have to take care of my responsibility. Isha time. You want to go to sleep. You feel tired and lazy. But first I have to take care of my responsibility. Salah teaches us to be responsible. The second quality Salah teaches us is selflessness. To explain this, Salah teaches us how to put something else before our own desires, before what I want to do right now. One of the big problems in relationships today is everyone is focused on themselves. I want this. The other person says, I want that. And it pulls them apart. Salah teaches you how to put something else before yourself. Again, as I just told you, the third time, I want to sleep. At the fourth time, I want to have lunch. At Asr time, I want to get work done. At Maghrib time, I want to eat dinner. At Isha time, I want to go to sleep. But I do not think about what I want to do at those times. I first put Allah and my salah before everything else. Sleep will come second. Lunch is secondary. Work is secondary. Everything else is secondary. Salah and Allah is first in life. It teaches you. And in relationships, if we could learn to put the other person first, think of them first before ourselves, not me, me, me. But think about what does the other person need? What does the other person want? It would bring people closer together. Join the hearts together. The third quality that Salah teaches us is humility. Humbleness. Tawadhu. And we understand this. It doesn't matter how handsome you are, how beautiful someone is, how wealthy and rich they are, how educated they are, how famous they are, how powerful they are. Doesn't matter. When we pray right now and we go into sujood, we will put our face on the ground. It reminds us where we came from. It reminds us where we will go back to. It reminds us what our reality is. It humbles us. And arrogance in personal relationships, in the home, at work, personal relationships, arrogance, it breaks the hearts of heart. Humility is how you win people, how you win the hearts. Salah teaches us to be humble. The fourth quality, forgiveness. Salah teaches us to be forgiving. That's a big problem. Look, people will make mistakes. People will make mistakes. To err is human. Everybody makes mistakes. But the problem becomes in personal relationships if the other person makes a mistake and I am not willing to forgive them. La abada. Not willing to forgive them. This breaks relationships. But Salah reminds us to be forgiving. How? Because think about how many sins I commit, you commit, we commit every single day. How many sins? Dhunub. How many sins do we commit every single day? But when we pray, what do we say? Allahumma inni dhalamtu nafsi dhulman kathira. Allah, I made a lot of sins. وَلَا يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. Only you can forgive me, O Allah. فَغْفِرْ لِي مَغْفِرَةً مِنْ عِنْدِكَ. Oh Allah, please, please forgive me. Every time we pray, we ask Allah to forgive us. Forgive, forgive, forgive. But the Prophet taught us the golden rule to live by. مَنْ لَا يَرْحَمْ لَا يُرْحَمْ. If somebody does not show others mercy, that person does not deserve mercy. If I am not willing to forgive the people in my life, the people that I say I love, my wife, my children, my brother, my sister, if I am not willing to forgive anyone for even small little things, what makes me think that I am deserving of the forgiveness of Allah? Why should Allah forgive me when I don't forgive anyone else? So Salah reminds us to be forgiven. Responsibility, selflessness, humility, forgiveness. Salah teaches us these qualities. And if we started praying, building these qualities within ourselves every single day, it would change our personal relationships. It would change the dynamics in our relationships. The relationship in the home, in the family, at work, in the community, it would change everything. This is the benefit of Salah. This is why Allah, when He is talking about problems in the home, in the middle, He says, take care of your prayer. Go back and learn your lesson so that you don't keep making the same mistakes in your relationships. And Umar ibn Khattab, Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar bin al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he probably summarized it best when he said, "Man kana lis-salati mudhi'an falighayriha adya." Whoever will be irresponsible, will not take care of his prayer, his salah, will be even more irresponsible about everything else in his life. فَمَنْ لَيْسَ فِيهِ خَيْرٌ لِرَبِّهِ فَكَيْفَ يَكُونُ فِيهِ خَيْرٌ لِغَيْرِهِ. Because if somebody cannot be good with Allah, if somebody cannot be good to Allah, then why would you ever expect that person to be good to anybody else? The one who created us, the one who feeds us, the one who sustains us, the one who gave us everything that we have. If we can't be good with him, why should anybody ever expect that we would be good with them? Barakallahu lana wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Azim. Wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-hakim. Astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li sa'il al-muslimin. Fastaghfiruhu innahu huwa al-ghafur. Wa salatu wa salam ala sayyidina al-mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man tabi'ahum ihsan ila yawmiddin wa ba'd. So we've been talking about how important, necessary, crucial, critical salah is in our life. But I wanted to present one last idea connected to this topic. There is probably someone here who is thinking, you say that salah has all these benefits, salah does all this good. I pray 5 times a day. Not just now. I've been praying 5 times a day for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20, 30, 40 years of my life. I have yet to see any of this benefit. I don't see this benefit, these qualities, this benefit coming from the prayer. I don't see it in my life. I pray, but I don't see this. What's the problem? What's missing? There is something missing. What's missing here is what the Quran calls khushu', quality within your prayer. You see, I can have the most expensive, powerful car in the world, but if I don't know how to drive it, if I don't drive it properly, it's not going to even get me from point A to point B. It won't get me home from here if I don't know how to drive it. And I can have the most beat up old car you've ever seen, but if I know how to drive it, I can get home from work. I can drive it from point A to point B. It's very simple logic. Doesn't need to be explained. But the problem is not in salah. The problem is in how I pray. Do I have quality in my prayer? Do I connect with Allah in my prayer? Do I actually feel something in my prayer? Do I experience something in my salah? Or am I just performing the ritual? That's the question we have to ask ourselves. First, start praying. Number two, then look at the quality. The quality of your prayer. Now, if the next question is, okay, I understand. I need quality in my prayer. I need khushu' in my salah. How do I get there? Very simple. Somebody might be curious. How can I say it's simple? It's such a huge problem. Everyone deals with it. But it's simple. There's a few things that we can do. The biggest recommendation that I will offer, there's lots of things that we can do. Ibn Rajab, rahimahullah ta'ala, he wrote a book where he talked about 110 different things that we can do to improve the quality of our prayer. But there's one really big, powerful thing we can do to improve the khushu' in our salah. Understand what you are saying, what you are reading within your salah. Because that will change your salah from just a performance, a ritual. You just stand there and you just read certain things. Tilawa, qira'ah, you're just reading, saying things. To actually being a conversation between us and Allah. You'll understand what you're saying. That when you go in sujood, You won't just be saying, SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah. But you'll be thinking, SubhanAllah, I am saying that how absolutely perfect, glorious, amazing, magnificent, mind-blowing is my Rabb, Allah. The one who created me. Rabb means the one who created, the one who feeds, the one who sustains, the one who protects. How amazing is He? Al-A'la, and He is the highest, the most exalted, above and beyond everything. And I am here in sujood with my face on the ground. I am in need of Him. He is the Rabb, I am the Abd. He is the Malik, I am the Mamluk. He is the owner, I am the property. He is the master, I am the slave. He is the one who feeds, I am the one who's in need. He is the one who bestows mercy, I am begging for His mercy. If you understand that, when you say SubhanAllah, think about that right now when you pray. When you go on sujood, then tell me if you don't feel it yourself. It changes the experience. We need to put time, we need to put work. Look at all the wonderful, beautiful people here today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed all of us with so much intelligence, so much ability, so many talents, so many resources. And you look at the accomplishments that are probably in this room, the education, the careers, the businesses. All the result of that blessing that Allah has given us, and talent and ability. We just need to take some and dedicate it to our salah. Learn, read, understand what you are reading and what you are saying in your prayer, your conversation with your Creator, and see if it doesn't change your experience of the salah. And when it changes your experience of the salah, your salah will have that khushu', that quality, then see how it starts changing your life. But اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم اهدنا واهدنا وجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى اللهم اعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك اللهم احسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى وصلى الله تعالى على النبي الكريم قال الله تعالى إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تسعون أقم الصلاة